This is every character who took the Demon Slayer title in order to finally defeat Muzan. And today, we'll go over and rank each of them and explain their final form. We'll start the video with the weakest characters in the series and later explain the more unknown transformations in the entire show. One very important note is that in order to make this video interesting, I'll rank each individual based on multiple factors rather than just raw strength. Like life story and circumstances, feats done in the show, like creating a new breathing form, near-death power output, and statements that was done in the show, like Giyome being the strongest Hashira. And by the end of the video, we'll answer some of the most popular questions fans are arguing about since the beginning. Like, who would win? Giyome in his awakened state or Akaza? Yorichi or Demon King Tanjiro? Let's start it off with Kenno. Kenno was always a quiet child due to her childhood trauma because of the fact she was sold into slavery. Despite all that, the Kocho sisters did their best to rehabilitate her after adopting her from slavery. There just wasn't much they could do to bring her out of her shell. Kenno seems to be quiet and weak, but don't be mistaken. She can hold her own against even the strongest demons. Her strength and speed was first known when she mastered Total Concentration Constant, which is a hell of a thing to master. She was also able to break the huge gourd that says to be made out of a special material and is harder than a normal one. Being a Sugoku of a Hashira is no easy feat. During the Hashira training arc, it was even said that it's very understandable that most Hashira in fact do not have a Sugoku because of their insane training pacing and capabilities. Kenno uses the same breathing style as her older sister Kanae, which is flower breathing, and it fits her perfectly. During her battle against Doma, the upper rank 2, the demon praised her for being very fast and said her body moved like a spring. Later on, Kenno is forced to use her final form, Equinoctial Vermilion Eye. This form is a focusing technique that raises the user's kinetic vision to its maximum. While she's using this technique, her brain power and vision are enhanced so much that to her, the world moves in slow motion. But the technique has its own drawbacks and is highly dangerous because it puts a huge strain on the eyes and could cause blood vessels to rupture, leading to partial or complete blindness. It can still be used even if the person has only one functioning eye though. This technique is probably there to mimic the effects of the see-through world, which is known to help the user attain such great speed that the entire world seems to slow down. That's the same technique that her sister Kanae used to keep Doma trapped till dawn, and later, it's the same technique she uses to kill him. After using the technique, Kanae gets blinded in her right eye, with the pupil losing its gradient and gaining a dark ring around it. Her determination to avenge her sisters is noble, but she still needed help from Inosuke to bring down Doma. And while it was still impressive, there are stronger demon slayers on our list. By the end of the show, she's pretty strong, but I'm putting her at the bottom of the list mostly because she was outclassed by pretty much everyone else in the show so quickly. In Season 1, when she first started training with the Doofus Trio, she was stronger than them by miles. Over time though, they didn't just catch up to her, they far surpassed her. Kaigaku at number 15 was a former Demon Slayer and Zenitsu's senior disciple under the former Thunder Hashira, Jigoro Kuwajima. Kaigaku went on a mission and ran into the upper rank 1, Kokoshibo. And in a pretty distasteful fashion, Kaigaku quickly surrendered himself to save his own skin, and later became a member of the 12 Kazuki. Admittedly, he wouldn't have had much of a chance against Kokoshibo anyways, but we'll get to him eventually. Before turning into an upper rank 6 demon, Kaigaku was exceptionally talented in the thunder breathing style, so much that the Thunder Hashira wanted Zenitsu to take notes from him. However, he can never learn the very first thunder breathing technique, Thunderclap and Flash, and because of that, his other thunder breathing techniques were left lacking. But as a demon, that barely mattered at all. His thunder breathing expertise gets supercharged by his new blood demon art, which allows him to take the visual effects of thunder breathing and turn them into reality. He even gets confident enough to say that his master is a senile old man, practically mocking a former Hashira. While it's pretty debatable that a guy that couldn't even master the first form of thunder breathing could beat a former Hashira, he's still admittedly overpowered thanks to these new abilities, even going as far as being able to overwhelm Zenitsu initially in their matchup. But eventually, Zenitsu doesn't just single-handedly defeat him. He does it pretty easily. Yeah, Zenitsu got injured in this fight pretty badly. But the fact that Kaigaku couldn't see Zenitsu's attacks twice means that their speed doesn't come close to being on the same level. Even as a demon, Kaigaku shows off just why he's so worthless. And the only reason why he's not at the bottom of the barrel is because his blood demon art mixed with lightning breathing makes him pretty formidable. But thunder breathing users are not the only ones that possess insane speeds. Shinobu, who comes in at number 14, actually shocked Upper Moon 2 Doma with her speed. Fun fact, Shinobu would actually come fourth in a running contest between the Hashira, surpassing everyone besides Tengen, Sanami, and Kiyome. Shinobu is the weakest Hashira on this list in terms of physical strength. She's so weak, in fact, that she's probably the only Hashira in history that's not strong enough to cut off a demon's head. But that's not enough to write her off just yet. She's easily one of the fastest of all the Hashira in the series, and easily makes up for her loss in strength with her specially made poison that can take out any demon. Well, almost any demon, that is. In her final battle during the Infinity Castle arc, she meets her perfect counter with Doma, the demon that killed her sister, and also the only demon she's ever fought against that can actively resist her poison and make it useless. Even with that though, her speed heavily carried her enough that she was able to put in one heck of a fight against him, despite her lacking strength. And after everything, even in death, she managed to be the main key to taking him out once and for all, ensuring that there's one less powerful demon to get in the way of taking out Muzan. Her general abilities show that physicality is not the only thing that's important when speaking about slaying demons. Her big brain when it comes to creating potions and drugs is comparable to none. But she's not the only one that has special abilities beyond just slicing off demon necks though. But she's easily the most specialized in that field. Next up has gotta be one of the best character final forms in anime history. The blonde-haired Demon Slayer is obviously skilled at what he does, but he's too shy and cowardly to do anything more than whimper and cry half the time. It's almost frustrating to watch him on screen. That is, at least until he passes out and his face freezes with concentration. Fun fact, Koyoharu stated that the reason Zenitsu is complaining so much about his training is because he's a city boy. He grew up sleeping on nice mattresses, eating good food, and basically living a compatible life compared to an Asuke and Tanjiro that lived in harsh conditions and had to work from day and night just to survive. But Zenitsu always had potential, because the first time we see an entirely new Zenitsu was when he instantly decapitated the tongue demon and defeated the son of the spider family by himself. His final form, however, easily puts him on par with a lot of the other slayers in the series, and it's confirmed that he's on a Hashira level due to the fact that he killed an Upper Moon and created an entirely new breathing form in an existing one. During his battle with Kaigaku in the Infinity Castle arc, Zenitsu, who had only been able to master the first form of thunder breathing, suddenly unlocked the strongest form of the technique, the seventh form, Flaming Thunder God, which looks very similar to the first form if you ask me. It's a personal touch to the thunder breathing style from Zenitsu himself. The user gets into a low pose and adjusts their stance before they dash forward at blinding speeds and unleash a singular forward slash, which is followed up by a cool-looking Japanese dragon shaped like a lightning bolt. With this form, he's able to blitz and decapitate an upper-ranked demon before it could even react. Zenitsu surpassed his limits once again against Muzan when he and Inosuke had an all-out assault against him, using his seventh form and godlike speed more than his body is capable of withstanding while asking his grandpa to kick his butt one last time for him. Unfortunately, he couldn't awaken his red sword, and all he could do in the final fight is stall Muzan long enough for Tanjiro to join the fight again. But even without the red sword upgrade, he could take out an upper-ranked demon. Then that means the rest of this video will just keep getting more awesome, and we'll soon answer the biggest questions in the show. The next on our list is the ladies' favorite, Inosuke. He's short-tempered and hot-headed, which are two personality traits that helped him progress and become one of the best of the best, especially considering the things he can do with his body and bones that no other human can ever dream of. He always likes to think he's the strongest fighter in every situation, and absolutely hates to lose. This trait pushes him to train harder and get stronger, but other times that puts him in disadvantaged situations against powerful enemies, and the rest of the time his own friends have to put him down. Over time, however, his brash personality gives way to a more rational and thoughtful demon slayer who's able to plan things accordingly and take his time. All things being considered, Inosuke is a prodigy. His physical capabilities are just insane. He's flexible like a cat, he can dislocate his limbs in order to fit into small holes, or make his arm longer like we see in his fight with Doma, when he made his arm longer in the last second in order to reach Doma's neck. Inosuke also has immense strength too. He was able to push the large boulder in Kiyome's training without awakening his mark. But what about his brain power? Although Inosuke seems to be dumb because he grew up in the mountains without formal education, he's a genius when it comes to fighting. He's very similar to Luffy or Goku in that regard. He invented beast breathing and constantly created new beast breathing forms on the spot depending on the situation. We see it during his fight with Kano against Doma. Inosuke suddenly created a new form, Throwing Strike, where he threw both of his blades in order to push Kano's sword and cut off Doma's head for good. That's easily one of the most impressive things in the whole series, and shows off the fact that Inosuke is a master of beast breathing, and maybe even a battle genius in his own right. But the strongest of the Demon Slayers are just ahead. And when it comes to physicality, we can't forget our flashy Hashira, which is stated to be the second physically strongest among the Hashira, and the first one to win a running competition between them. Next up, at number 11, is Tengen Uzui, a man of many melons. Tengen is the second strongest Hashira when it comes to physical strength. He's the fastest Hashira when it comes to running. But although his physical capabilities are out of this world, he doesn't consider himself as a prodigy, as seen by the fact he said to Gyotaro that he's not special, and referred to Muichiro and Kiyome as real prodigies. And he's kinda right. Although he's physically stronger than Muichiro, Muichiro did manage to kill Lower Moon 5 with low difficulty, and Tengen struggled with Gyotaro. Some people suggest that Tengen would have defeated Gyotaro much easier if he didn't get poisoned, but this is irrelevant because Muichiro got poisoned as well. Regardless, Tengen is a powerhouse, and his peak came during the Entertainment District arc, where he went head-to-head with Gyotaro in a near-suicidal battle. His strongest form is the fifth form, String Performance, which is very similar to the fourth form, where the user holds the chain of their twin swords and rotates the blades at high speed while charging forward. The spin of the blades without changing grip allows for continual slashes while still being in motion. This has devastating offensive capabilities and can tear anything in its way to shreds. That, along with his enhanced hearing and amazing visual prowess, allows him to read into his enemy's moves and perfectly predict their attacks. Considering the amount of destruction their fight ended up dishing out to the district, and just how close he was to taking out Gyutaro, it's a real shame that his injuries and the trauma of the fight caused him to retire as a Demon Slayer. But even with all these, he still couldn't kill Gyutaro alone. So while he's powerful in his own right, he's just not that high on the list considering he would have died by the end of that battle if Nezuko and the others weren't around to support him. Tengen required the help of the trio and Nezuko in order to defeat Gyotaro and Daki, but the next Demon Slayer on our list killed an Upper Moon on his own. Well, sorta. Muichiro Tokito is honestly one of the more interesting characters, especially considering the fact that he's the youngest of all the Hashira, if not almost all the characters in the show. Even with that, he managed to completely overwhelm Upper Moon 5 with no effort at all. I guess that's to be expected, considering the fact that he has the blood of one of the strongest Demon Slayers in history running through his veins. Although Muichiro is very skinny and small, he didn't flinch when Tanjiro tried to move his hand by force, and that's thanks to the fact that Muichiro is a prodigy. He not only became a Hashira in just 2 months, he also created his own breathing form. The seventh form, Obscuring Clouds, is a personal creation of his. It's a movement-based technique designed to heavily mess up its target. When the user appears in front of the target, they move incredibly slow, but then accelerate to crazy speeds before getting a hit in, making it seem like they're disappearing into a cloud of mist. When done repeatedly, it can disorientate the target to the point of making them think they're being covered in a thick layer of mist. We first see this skill when he killed Kyoko and later in his fight against his demon ancestor, the Upper Moon 1, Kokushibo. The new form looks like a shadow as Muichiro disorients Kokushibo and takes over the battle long enough to turn the tides even just a little bit. Since the entire battlefield is turned into a mist-filled arena that only Muichiro can navigate through, it's almost like he takes a page out of Jujutsu Kaisen and casts a domain expansion. And that's not even close to where he gets by the end of the series. During his battle against Kyoko, Muichiro unlocks his Demon Slayer mark, which manifests as three dark red clouds on his face. Just like other Hashira, with the mark, he gets almost overwhelmingly powerful, to the point where he not only shrugged off the effects of a powerful paralytic poison and used mist-breathing forms in rapid succession. In his final moments, Muichiro gained access to the transparent world and made his sword red in order to pin down Kokushibo in place. This, alongside with Genya's blood demon art, prevented Kokoshibo from releasing a technique, turning the tides toward the demon slayers long enough for Giyome and Sanami to finally kill him. He was also the first among all the Hashira to realize just how to activate the bright red Nichiren sword and pass it to the rest, boosting their powers to unheard of levels. But Moichiro wasn't the only one that unlocked his Demon Slayer mark on that fateful day in the Swordsmith Village. Mitsuri was actually meant to be the Sugoku of Rengoku, but couldn't keep up with his training. This made it much crazier considering the fact that her muscle density is 8 times as dense as a regular human, making her even stronger than a chimpanzee. Mitsuri is also one of the only Hashira that uses a special sword designed just for her, and with it, she can unleash a devastating flurry of attacks by constantly flicking and retracting her whip like a katana over and over, slashing at the opponent and wearing them down. And then there's her Demon Slayer mark, which manifested in the middle of her fight against Zohakuten. It takes the form of two hearts upside down and opposite from each other, with angel wings on both sides where the two heart tips meet that appear near her neck. She was already fast enough to dodge lightning from Zohakuten, and strong enough to rip off Muzan's arm with her bare hands, which shocked the Demon King. But with her Demon Slayer mark, she enters another level of speed and strength, which almost puts her on the same level as Giyome and Sanami. And you'll see just how strong they are in a bit, so for her to be even close to them says a lot. She could probably have gone below Moichiro, but the fact that she was able to have a one-on-one with an upper rank 4 and put in a significant amount of work in the final battle against Muzan, it's obvious that she's just a little above him. Remember, we're factoring every single factor and comparing them in our pick. If Moichiro had time to grow up, he would probably be much higher in our list. Next, we have a man of few words at number 7, Gyu Tomioka. He's the Water Hashira and the Demon Slayer that kicks off Tanjiro's entire story. If anyone else but him had encountered the Kamado siblings in the mountains that fateful day, the story would have gone a lot differently. Tanjiro would never have become a Demon Slayer, and Muzan would win for sure. He usually comes off as cool and aloof with a simple and reserved personality. But deep down, he's battling an inferiority complex that stems from his inability to save his sister and grew even worse after he gets rescued by his friend Sabato, who dies to his injuries while he failed to kill any demons during the exam, becomes a Water Hashira. Despite his reservations about the position, he still does a pretty damned good job at it, even creating his own water-breathing form that has intense defensive capabilities. Giyu's final form, the 11th form, Dead Calm, is his personal creation and involves the user ceasing all body movements and entering a state of complete tranquility. With a clear mind, he's able to deflect, block, and cut any incoming attacks with imperceptible speed. It's a pretty solid defense against most enemies, but on occasion, really fast or numerous attacks can still find their way through. He uses this move for the first time when he goes up against lower rank 5, Rui, and slices his head off pretty easily. Even during his fight with Akaza and in the final battle against Muzan, Dead Calm proved itself useful on multiple occasions, negating a lot of attacks and allowing Giyu to protect his companions during battle. For a guy with an inferiority complex, he sure is pretty strong. And he only gets stronger as he unlocks his Demon Slayer mark in that same fight, allowing him to momentarily outpace Akaza and allowing him to keep up with the Upper Moon for long periods of time. The mark appears as a fluid, water-like design on his left cheek. Finally, during the fight against Muzan, Sanami forcefully clashes his sword together with Giyu's, turning both of their blades temporarily red, giving him all the abilities that come with it. Giyu is the second Hashira that survived against Muzan, and he actually managed to keep up with Sanami back in the Hashira training arc, and even hit so hard both wooden swords broke. This is not an easy feat to pull off. He's the second strongest in the core after all. But even so, Giyu is one of the strongest, and we still have 7 more slayers to go. At number 7 is the enthusiastic Kyojuro Rengoku, the Flame Hashira, who trained himself using the Guidebook of Flame Breathing after his father stopped training him. Let that sink in for a second. He taught himself flame breathing through a freaking book. If that's not impressive, I don't know what is. Here's another fun fact about Rengoku. It turns out his surname means purgatory, which is what his 9th form, Rengoku, is capable of putting a demon in. It's his most powerful flame breathing technique, where the user takes a stance with their sword before charging at a high speed. We never got to see Rengoku at his full potential since he was unfortunately taken out by Akaza during the Mugen Train arc. But still, he fought against the demon so fiercely and with such speed that both Inosuke and Tanjiro were rooted to their spot and couldn't move out of fear of only getting in the way of the fight. The battle was so intense, there was absolutely nothing they can do to help Rengoku in any way. Imagine just how overpowered he'd have become if he awakened his Demon Slayer mark before he died. Leave a comment on what your headcanon of Rengoku's mark would have looked like. The fact that he was still incredibly powerful and managed to get through that entire fight without letting a single person other than him die, even though he didn't have a Demon Slayer mark, goes to show that he was on an entirely different level of strength and could have easily become one of the strongest Hashira. But how can we calculate the physical capabilities of a character we had barely met? Well, did we mention that he trained himself in flame breathing by reading a book? But what else? Rengoku had the record of never letting anyone die under his watch, which is crazy enough. Doing so many things at once is an ability only few people can do. But the most impressive feat of Rengoku was the fact that he held Akaza in place with his bare hands. Gripping someone with your hand and donut stomach is hard enough. Now take this person and make him the Upper Moon 3 Akaza, and you can realize why Rengoku is on the top of our list. If Rengoku would have survived his encounter with Akaza and didn't retire due to injury or something, I'm 100% sure he would be one of the first ones to awaken his mark and provide much needed support in the fight against Muzan. The Rengoku bloodline dates all the way back to the Sengoku era, and maybe even more, and our next Demon Slayer is alive thanks to it. Obanai is actually one of the weakest members of the Hashira in terms of physical strength, and he's not a very fast runner too. He'll be behind all the Hashira except Muichiro and Kanroji in a running contest. So how come a relatively weak individual that's low on most of the physical attributes became one of the strongest members of the Hashira? Well, for every ounce of muscle Obanai lacks, he makes it up for in skill and brain power. Obanai was the first one who unlocked his bright red sword just by hearing the crow describing how it was done, and his mark was also shown in the battle against Muzan. His strongest breathing form, the fifth form Slithering Serpent, has the user curve their sword in multiple directions and slices his opponent, making it capable of decapitating multiple enemies at once. The twisting of his blade is possible because of his unique Nichiren katana and fighting style. His sword is a heavily modified katana similar in appearance to an Indonesian kris sword, with a blade shape modeled into waves resembling a slithering snake. That's only fitting for the Serpent Hashira after all, but it's not just his breathing style that sets him apart from the other Hashira. It's also his connection with snakes, especially his companion, Kapuramaru. Obanai has always been partially blind in his right eye, so he takes advantage of his bond with his snake, Kapuramaru. Kapuramaru possesses a unique ability which allows him to read and predict a target's attacks and then relay that information to Obanai. Much like Muichiro, he unlocked the transparent world, allowing him to see Muzan's vital spots, which are 7 hearts and 5 brains, and also like we said before, managed to grip his blade tight enough to turn it bright red. In the last fight against Muzan, his fighting style proved itself to be a perfect match for Muzan's weird movements and multiple limbs. But what would happen when you combine crazy skill, crazy strength, and crazy temper? Well, you get Sunami. The Wind Hashira is a hot-blooded and rash person who hates demons with his entire being. In fact, during the trial against the Kamado siblings, Sunami is the first to try to go against Nezuko being kept alive, and he's the loudest too. He goes the extra mile of cutting his own skin to tempt Nezuko into attacking him so he can prove that she's just a demon. Although Sunami is hot-headed and always rushing into action, he's not stupid. He's actually a prodigy when it comes to killing demons. Before he became a Demon Slayer and learned how to use breaths, he was killing lower-level demons left and right with simple tools, tying them down to places until the sun came up. Even as a kid, he managed to kill his own mother who became a demon. Even a skilled swordsman like Kokushibo struggled against a demon that killed his entire samurai squad. A lot of the credit for his demon killing days goes to his special Marichi blood, which is rare even among other people who have this kind of blood. Sanami would use his own blood to confuse the demons and then attack them with all he has until he caught the attention of the Demon Slayer Corps. His bravado and occasional overconfidence is backed up by a good amount of strength. He's not just all talk, he's one of the fastest among the Hashira. That's saying a lot considering most of the other Hashira can move around so fast that it almost looks like they're teleporting. On top of that, he was able to hold his own against upper rank 1, Kokushibo. That might mostly be because he has the most experience killing demons than all the other Hashira. That's because after his mother turned into a demon and attacked his brothers and sisters, Sanami started his Demon Slayer journey by killing her, before going on to kill every demon he could find with suicidal devotion. And that was long before he knew about breathing styles, Nichiren blades, and even Demon Slayers in general. All he needed were his fists and whatever was hard enough to knock a demon to the ground. That would explain why he's so jacked and has the muscles of a Greek god. And those big muscles aren't for nothing. Even as a demon slayer and a Hashira, they come in handy when he awakens his demon slayer mark during his battle with Kokushibo. The mark resembles a single green paper origami windmill with two dots on both sides of his right cheek. The mark dramatically increases his physical capabilities, allowing Sanemi to fight with Kokushibo and even momentarily overpowering him in strength, despite being grievously injured and slashed across his abdomen. Of course, Sanemi wouldn't have been able to take down Kokushibo on his own, but to be honest, who could? Regardless, even if he wasn't the only one to cut down the upper rank one, he was still a major asset to the fight. And it's not like Sanemi is just a muscle head either. He has incredible control over his body, like how he was able to force his muscle tissue to close during the battle with Kokushibo after getting cut in the stomach. On top of that, he might just be a battle genius too. He managed to figure out that forcefully clashing his blade against the weapons of his fellow Hashira turned them bright red, boosting both their battle capabilities. Turning his blade red even allowed him to slow down Muzan's regeneration. He's a major asset, and if it wasn't for who's next up, I would have ranked him higher than 5th on the list, and even as the strongest Hashira. But that title belongs only to one man. And that's Gyome, the Stone Hashira, who is easily the strongest of all the Hashira. And we don't use that term loosely either. Gyome is, well, he's Gyome. If you've watched Demon Slayer, you know just why he needs no introduction. The other Hashira definitely don't need to be told twice about just how powerful he is. Just a clap of his hands was enough to shut everyone's mouths in an instant. His average training regimen is pushing a boulder the size of a small truck through a village with the same amount of effort I'd use to pick a pebble off the floor. And he knows just how strong he is too. During his teenage years, while he was taking care of 9 orphan children, a demon attacked their home and killed almost all of them, forcing Gyome to put those huge muscles to use and punch the demon down until he couldn't move and died in the sunlight. After doing this, Gyome himself said that his newfound strength was terrifyingly powerful. Even the big guy himself is scared of just how strong he is. But other than being super strong, Gyome is the most impressive of all the Hashira, because on top of being the most intimidating and powerful, he's also blind. That makes you wonder if he'd be even more fearsome if he had his sight. His final form, just like most other Hashira, comes during the Infinity Castle arc during his fight with the Upper Moon One, Kokushibo. During this fight, he learns to turn his Nichiren Katana bright red just like the other Hashira. But on top of that, he also used his Demon Slayer mark in the middle of battle. The mark appears as a cracked earth fissure-like pattern on both of his forearms. The mark increases his physical capabilities to new heights and allows him to keep up with Upper Moon 1. And just like the element his breathing form takes after, Gyome has a calm and stable mind. That's one of the things that puts him just above Sanemi on this list. With the repetitive action technique that he taught to Genya, he's able to increase his concentration to a new level. Genya even used this technique to make up for the fact that he can't use breathing styles. He does this by opening all 5 senses while constantly praying the Japanese meditative practice. It allows him to focus all the muscles in his body and enhance them far beyond their normal capabilities. A demon slayer that manages to combine both their breathing style and repetitive action can gain immense strength that even rivals upper ranks of the 12 Kazuki to some extent. And that makes you wonder, with the amount of strength and the full physical power of the repetitive action technique, how well would Gyome have done if he fought against Akaza? Akaza and Gyome are some of the most powerful people in the Demon Slayer universe, and putting them against each other is one of the biggest questions asked by Demon Slayer fans, since we saw what these two juggernauts are capable of. Gyome, on one hand, is strong enough to crush rocks and bones effortlessly with his large hands and his towering frame. In terms of raw strength, no one can keep up with him. But that doesn't mean Akaza isn't strong himself, especially with his blood demon art, Destructive Death, that gives him explosive amounts of destructive abilities and the ability to detect attacks before they reach him. But with this awakened Demon Slayer mark and his repetitive action technique, Gyome carries this match on his back pretty well. Yeah, Akaza has the power to regenerate his body even after decapitation, but he can't really do much when it comes to getting up close and personal with the strongest Hashira of the current generation. The martial arts training and range that Akaza has from his previous life isn't going to help him either. Thanks to the red Nichiren blade and access to the see-through world, Gyome can evade most of the things Akaza throws at him and deal one hell of a blowback each time. Moreover, even Kokushibo couldn't break Gyome's chains because they're made of Nichiren ore. I I can see Guillaume weakening Akaza long enough to put him down in place until the sun comes up. Guillaume wins this with a mid to high diff at best and avenges Rengoku. But Akaza is just an upper rank 3. He has two demons that easily outclass him in every way, and one of them just happens to be on this list. It's only fitting that we transition from the strongest Hashira to the strongest upper rank, Kokoshibo. Kokoshibo is a terrifying entity that needed many awakened Hashira-level demon slayers with unfathomable difficulty to bring down. And even then, he still took out a couple with him. But before becoming a fearsome demon, he was a fearsome demon slayer named Michikatsu Sugikuni and the older twin brother of Yorichi Sugikuni. So of course, the older brother of such a beast would also be insanely powerful and the strongest demon. And he's not just the strongest demon in name either. Kokoshibo has been challenged 3 times for his position as Muzan's right-hand killing machine, and he won every single time. Akaza was one of these 3 challenges, and Kokoshibo usually just absorbs the demons he defeats, but he let Akaza live because he enjoyed the challenge. As a human, Michikatsu was a jealous and bitter but powerful man. He was almost killed by a demon as a samurai, but that didn't stop him from creating his own breathing style from sun breathing known as moon breathing, which was not as powerful as his brother's sun breathing, but was easily just as devastatingly overpowered. Unfortunately, since he was filled with pride and was jealous of never being able to surpass his brother, he was persuaded by Muzan to become a demon. Under the command of his new king, Michikatsu, now named Kokoshibo, wiped out any demon slayers that had successfully learned sun breathing and became the highest ranking demon almost immediately. He held the title for hundreds of years, even after his brother's death centuries ago. Even after that, he still shaped history by killing the leader of the Demon Slayer Corps. This caused the Corps to take extra care in hiding the residence of future leaders, and also caused the Kakoshi to be formed. With a new title and more strength than anyone could ever hope to challenge alone, Kokoshibo ditched the normal Nichiren blade in favor of a katana created from his own flesh and blood. Thanks to his body's immense durability and hardness, he can make it to be just as sharp, if not more so, than a normal Nichiren weapon. One of his most devastating techniques he has is his blood demon art, because he transformed his breathing style to a blood demon art. His breathing style became real, and the most terrifying part of it is that he doesn't even need to swing his sword in order to use it. All he has to do in order to activate his breathing style is to wish it, and the technique just comes out of his blade. Moreover, Kokoshibo can create blades from his body, effectively making his entire body one big blade from which he can unleash techniques. Still, even after several centuries of experience as a demon slayer and as a demon himself, the fact that he's still far weaker than Muzan proves one key point. Even though he's easily the most powerful person just after Muzan, we have to put him at number 3. He still has never managed to surpass the one true king of Demon Slayer, Yorichi Sugikuni. The only man that has single-handedly struck a fear of Muzan so deep that it even lives in his cells. And we'll get to him in a second, don't you worry. Before we do though, we just have to talk about number 2, the man that almost won the war for both the humans and the demons, Tanjiro Kamado. Wait, how's Tanjiro number 2? Just hear me out here, okay? Tanjiro's Demon Slayer journey started after he came home from a trip selling charcoal, only to find his family slain like animals, and his sister Nezuko barely hanging on to life. He tries to save his sister, only to find out that she too had become a demon. But even then, while she was inches away from chomping off his face, he still had faith in her and knew that she would never hurt anyone, whether she was a demon or not. Giyu then suddenly appears and tries to kill Nezuko, thinking she's about to eat Tanjiro. But Tanjiro protected her to Giyu's surprise and started fighting him. Yep, even in the first episode, Tanjiro almost took out a Hashira with a dirty trick using his axe. That brief moment was enough to convince Giyu that the kid had potential, and he wasn't the only one that thought that either. Rengoku has always had faith in Tanjiro right from the moment they first met down to his final moments. And as Akaza himself, Rengoku's killer, would later confirm, Rengoku's predictions for Tanjiro were spot on. The kid was strong, and definitely wasn't someone you should overlook. Just like most other demon slayers, he has his own set of superhuman skills, like his sensitive sense of smell and his reputably hard skull, which is used to headbutt and stagger the Wind Hashira Sanami, along with several other demons, including upper ranks like Kiyotaro and Akaza. There's no foe that hasn't met the brunt of that head. On his impenetrable skull is his Demon Slayer mark in the form of a flame-like pattern, which he first awoke while fighting Kiyotaro. It was once a burn scar that changed into an amazing design, and proved just how much he'd grown till that point. It's well deserved too, considering that during that battle, he properly used the Hinokami Kagura for the first time, giving a glimpse of just how powerful sun breathing really is. His still lackluster sun breathing was still enough to terrify Ducky. Imagine just how powerful the true sun breathing user must have been. Tanjiro managed to move a giant boulder, master the see-through world, and use the 13th form of sun breathing all on his own. Yeah, he got help from others, but we need to give him some credit for his insane potential and physical capabilities. But I guess we can't call this Tanjiro's strongest form, can we? His true final form comes just after the Infinity Castle arc. As a last-ditch effort to keep the demon race alive, Uzan turns Tanjiro into the new Demon King. Tanjiro, who's already at a Hashira's level of strength at the time and on the verge of mastering sun breathing, becomes an absolute menace at this point. He obtains eyes with slit pupils, fangs, and flame-shaped marks over his left forehead and right jaw that are kind of like those of Kokushibo, in addition to a third, smaller flame-shaped mark coming down from the right side of his head down to his eyebrow after he conquered the weakness to sunlight. Yushiro said that he has potential as a demon that far surpassed that of Muzan himself. And fun fact, there's a theory out there that says that the reason Nezuko and Tanjiro were able to conquer the sun so fast is because they ate the blue spider lily when they were children. With that newfound strength and power, Tanjiro immediately became the strongest creature alive. The only thing that kept him from wiping out every demon slayer in the area was Nezuko doing her best to hold him back while they tried to inject him with the cure. It doesn't take a genius to know that if this version of Tanjiro was allowed to escape, especially since he was immune to sunlight, he would be an even bigger threat to humanity than Muzan could ever hope to be. With his new abilities as the Demon King, just before he got turned back into a human, there's only one man who could ever hope to stand up against him. So let's settle arguably the biggest debate in Demon Slayer. Who would win? Demon King Tanjiro or Yorichi? Yorichi and Michikatsu were born into the Tsukikuni clan in the middle of the Sengoku period, which was a time when twins were considered to be an extremely bad omen. Yorichi in particular was born with an odd birthmark on his forehead, which caused his father to declare that he would kill him. He was narrowly saved by his mother, who grew to love the child as her favorite. For the well-informed, you would know that the odd birthmark he was born with is actually a Demon Slayer mark, which means that right from birth, Yorichi was destined to be the most powerful swordsman to ever exist. In his childhood, without any prior sword experience whatsoever, he beat a swordsmaster with only 4 blows, knocking the guy down and leaving big bruises. Because of this, his father hoped to have him become the heir to the clan after he passed on. Yorichi didn't want that and decided to run away, leaving the clan to his brother. While living as a runaway, he met a girl named Uta, who he decided to live with. She later became pregnant, and while Yorichi left to find a midwife to help deliver the baby, Uta and the unborn child were killed by a demon. This motivated Yorichi to become a demon slayer, and later the strongest that had ever existed. It's ironic to think that if that demon had just looked the other way, Muzan's plan might have gone very differently, since Yorichi would have never shown sun breathing to the Hashira. Yorichi's access to the transparent world and selfless state, as well as his physique, polished to the highest caliber, and innate swordsmanship talent makes him easily the most terrifying demon slayer that has ever existed, even centuries after his death. Even his red sword is more special than the other ones, making even Muzan's regeneration come to a halt and burning him on a cellular level for almost 500 years. The only other person I can think of that could possibly stand up to Yorichi is the second strongest person I talked about on this list, the new Demon King, Tanjiro Kamado. The biggest question I have now is who would win in a fight between Demon King Tanjiro and Yorichi? That's a question I'm sure every Demon Slayer fan has thought about at least once. Well, one thing we know for sure is that it would be a fight for the century. Both swordmasters in their own right, of course. But considering the fact that Tanjiro was still a newly reborn demon, that according to Muzan, his sun breathing technique is practically child's play compared to Yorichi, I would still give this fight to the Demon Slayer. Albeit with mid to high difficulty, considering that an amateur version of sun breathing is still sun breathing. But that begs the question. What about a more experienced Tanjiro with more kills under his belt and several years worth of practice with his new demon powers and mastery over the Hinokami Kagura? Maybe just like Kagaku, he could learn to combine a newly formed blood demon art with sun breathing. I don't even think Yorichi could stand a chance against such a creature. So, when we put the truly powerful Demon King Tanjiro against a peak level Yorichi, I'm gonna have to give the final fight to Tanjiro. The kid just has every trick in the book, and as a Demon King in his prime, even Muzan would have to bow down to him. The world ends, and Tanjiro rules over it with a powerful iron fist. The only way I see it not happening is if Yorichi would find a move that can destroy Tanjiro's body like he did with Muzan's pieces of flesh. Check out our latest Demon Slayer video that pops up on the screen right now.